We are reconvening. Let's pick up where we left off on general provisions options under the guidance of Mike Ward.
Thank you. So we've gone through the ones that I think it was important to go through first. I would suggest that for the rest, we just move along and take them as they come. So the next one will be rules and regulations.
And let me just mention, this is also written for a city, so I can,
yes,
if we want to go for this, I'll put town in.
City would need to be replaced by town.
Mayor was replaced by town manager.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, I think you know the drill.
So I would recommend that we pass over this as written at any rate, and I'll tell you why. A copy of all rules and regulations, that would include police and fire departments, who particularly police departments, I'm not so sure that those documents should be easily accessible as public information for security and safety reasons.
Yeah, and you know, if you want a Board of Health regulation, you go to the Board of Health. I don't think you necessarily go to the town clerk.
Yeah, I agree with that.
So there's a consensus, George?
That by Board of Health should be filed with the town clerk. I don't think any regulation really should be in force, except perhaps for the police, unless it's filed with the town clerk. There has to be one place
right.
where everything resides, and that's the town clerk's office.
Well,
so that there's
so you're talking
official.
All the building regulations, all the zoning regulations,
yeah.
all of the conservation commission
sure.
regulations.
Sure.
Any of our regulations that we change, bylaws or anything, a copy goes down to the town clerk for it.
Yeah, but your stuff is zoning.
Yeah.
And that's
so
really kind of treated a little
separately.
No, it's treated separately, I mean.
One at a time.
Can we then clarify what we mean by rules and regulations and not, so it does not include the rules and regulations for the operation, specific operation of a department? You're talking about rules and regulations as it pertains to zoning and things along that line, which, yeah, that people should be able to go to the clerk's office and get that information.
A copy of all bylaws?
So, wait, why don't we say all rules and regulations established by a board or committee of the town?
Because the rules and regulations for the police department and fire department under current has to be adopted by the Board of Selectmen.
Under the current one.
Well, I would assume then would have to be, town manager would adopt them.
Town manager's going to adopt, so it would be different.
I'd be okay with boards and committees.
I'm just trying to avoid the rules and regulations that govern the emergency
yeah.
operations.
But I think we've taken care of that.
Mm-hmm.
If by boards.
Boards and committees.
Boards and committees.
Perfect.
So is that?
I heard that.
The rules and regulations.
I didn't say I agree with you. I said perfect.
Ralph.
Eric, the rules and regulations you're talking about, is that still considered open documents for the town?
Some are and some are not. After 2011, there was, and I'm going to be very vague here because I don't remember the specifics of it, but there was some legislation adopted that made some aspects of the operations of emergency services not open, subject to
right.
the
open meeting or
public
information.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, for example, the town's comprehensive emergency management plan. Prior to that legislation, you used to be able to just walk in and get a copy. Now
right.
you can't just walk in and get a copy.
Would it be easier then to say a copy of the rules and regulations, which are, what was the wording you just used?
Which are subject to the Freedom of Information Act or
right.
whatever they call it,
Massachusetts Public Records Act.
Yeah.
All rules and regulations subject to the Massachusetts
Public Records
Act shall be
available
from the clerk's
town
office.
Clerk's office.
And that way there,
it's public.
If it's
yeah.
if it's public, it's available. If it's not public, it's not available.
Yeah.
Okay.
Fine.
Mm-hmm. Don't ask me to put that into.
Yeah. if you don't have an official repository, then you can have three different versions of the same regulation floating around. So you got to say, what's the official regulation is the one on file with the town clerk. It's that simple.
So are we rewriting?
So how about we do this? We'll put the town clerk shall, the town clerk's office shall receive and keep on file all rules and regulations that are subject to the Massachusetts public records law. Try to keep it simple.
Yeah, one sentence.
I would actually take the wording as is and insert after town agency, which are subject to the Massachusetts Public Records Act, and keep the rest of the wording the same.
For in regards to timing and that sort of thing,
yeah.
That's why.
Well, I could take mayor out of there.
Well, that's coming out.
And I will say this language is very, I mean, I'm looking across three town charters now that all have almost the same language here.
I just have a question, because being the recipient of many FOIA requests, there's a lot of information that gets redacted out. To have that information available to the clerk, who may make a copy and send it out without redaction, could be a violation.
Well, this is sort of general rules and regulations, not about any specific case or anything like that.
But so if it resides, do we need to put anything in there? I mean, when we start talking about Public Records Act, it is available under the Public Records Act of Massachusetts to request the information, but who is the authorizing the authority to release the information? Is that the town clerk? Is that automatically false? Because they have a copy of it, they're going to make a copy?
They're the official keeper of the records.
Right.
Yeah. But they're not the official respondent with regards to certain information that has to be redacted out.
Why would you have to redact things out of rules and regulations?
We're not just talking about, we're talking about stuff that falls under Freedom of Information.
No,
this is rules and regulations.
Adopted by
that's
town
my, that was my
agency,
question. Yeah, I just want to make sure we're clear.
Rules and regulations.
Yeah, there's no personnel or anything that would have to be, that would be subject to redacting.
Personal information,
redacting.
Things of that nature.
Not in this one.
Okay. So, do you want me to read what I think
please.
I have? Okay, so a copy of all rules and regulations adopted by, and I have boards and committees, I don't know if that's a change that we wanted to make, which are subject to the Massachusetts Public Records Act, shall be placed on file in the office of the town clerk not later than the effective date of the rule or regulation, and shall be available for review, by any person who requests such information at any reasonable time. Unless an emergency exists, as determined by the town manager, no rule or regulation adopted by a town agency shall become effective until at least 5 days following the date it is filed.
Should agency mirror the
right?
Yeah.
The same board or committee?
Adopted by boards, a board or commission. Or however
you worded it, should that last sentence mirror that?
Okay, yeah.
Yes.
And then with that change, I'd make a motion to adopt.
I'll second.
Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say yes.
Aye.
Sorry, I'm switching.
Just change the whole thing.
Any nays or noes?
Yes.
All right, let's switch seats now and see what happens.
All right, and thank you, Tanya, for doing that on the fly. Next favorite.
So the next, we probably
general laws.
You probably can dismiss that because we have in the definitions.
Yeah.
This is more for if you don't have a definition section,
okay.
Which some don't.
All right, so we can get rid of, anyone have objections to just skipping over references to general laws?
No.
Very good. Computation of time. I do know we've had some issues in the past over computation of time. Has everyone read it?
Yeah, I got to read it again because I'm not sure I absorbed it all when I read it last night.
I'll make a motion to accept the language as written.
I'll second it.
I'll give a second for a recap to overall, it pretty much, I think, because in the past, we have issues where for submitting for warrant articles, whether weekends, how are weekends counted, and then if you have a holiday, this kind of covers it and gives a guideline. So there's no question.
So you didn't see a charter where his language was a little cleaner, like computation of time shall exclude Saturdays, Sundays, and official holidays?
Well, I mean, the last couple sentences here are for when it's a short amount of time, so I can understand why you might want to talk about that. I see what you're saying.
I think I have somewhere seen another version. Let me see what I can pull up here.
It's just a long way of saying, don't count the first day, weekends or holidays.
Yeah, that's all.
Yeah.
Yeah, or if you just have a 7-day time period, then it will be slightly different.
Right.
So in the computer time under the charter, if 7 days or fewer only business days, not including Saturdays, Sundays, or legal holidays, shall be counted. If more than 7 days, every day shall be counted, provided, however, if the last day of the period so computed would fall on a Saturday, Sunday, or legal holiday, the period shall end at 5:00 p.m. on the first business day following such Saturday, Sunday, or legal holiday.
Is that
better? Actually, that one is to me. That one.
Oh, you like that one? Yeah.
That one I don't have to go back and say, wait a minute, okay, again. I like that one.
I like that one better.
Yeah.
Ralph.
I do understand.
You like that one too?
Yeah.
Right now we're talking about the computation of time, which, a 10-day period, 30-day period. We do have specific dates earlier in the charter, like April 1st, July 1st. What happens when those fall on a Saturday or a Sunday? We have that now in our bylaw where it specifically said the first Monday of May or something like that. No petitions could be accepted after that. And yet the Board of Selectmen chose to extend the time, even though there was a set day. Are we going to make any provision in there that said if that day is a holiday, it's the next day, or if it falls on a weekend?
Well, in the charter so far, all we've done is say something has to be done before a certain date, not on a certain date.
Right.
Before that date.
Yes, by that date.
Not on that date.
Well, that's what our bylaw states now, and that didn't make a difference. They extended it beyond it, even though the bylaw said,
but it'll go back to the town manager.
Yeah, I don't see where we have to really.
That's, I mean,
back to our Board of Selectmen, and anyway.
Well, no, that's why to your point, we go to the town. The town manager is going to enforce this. Okay.
So that's, I think, am I correct in saying you withdrew your motion?
Yeah.
Whoever seconded it, are you okay with that?
Yes. I seconded it.
So then I would make a motion that we adopt the language that Mike recited to us. Do you want it reread?
I'll second that motion.
Okay.
Discussion?
I still think it's too confusing.
Really, I thought the second one, to me, was much more clear.
I thought it was, too.
I think we should have, the third Saturday after Columbus Day.
When the crows are flying.
Yeah, and only if it's above 70 degrees.
All right, so we have a motion on the table. Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Nay.
Motion passes as read. Whatever charter you pulled that
Winthrop.
I can't believe we just adopted the language and confused the lawyer.
Yeah.
And then didn't hear the language he offered, though.
Yeah. No, I'm trying to make it as simple for an average person to read.
Yeah.
Well, and that wasn't
but
easy.
With,
see, I think it was, by comparison.
But it was easier to digest.
Once they redid the open meeting law and how you post meetings, it complicated everything.
I know, but it's...
And to simplify...
We should make it as simple as possible.
I agree with that, but because it's so complex now, I think it's hard to simplify it so that everybody understands it. I agree, but I just see that as a big stumbling block.
All right. Next, oaths or affirmations for the office of town council, school committee, etc.
I don't understand this one.
Yeah, let's just do away with it.
Yeah, we don't need this one.
Because I think the next section pretty much covers it.
It does, it does.
Is everyone comfortable with that?
Yes.
It was extremely confusing.
It would have to be extensively rewritten if we were to adopt it.
Right, but the next one takes care of it.
Well, and I didn't see what purpose it served.
It did, if you read the following one, it took care of everything.
Yeah.
Certificate of election or appointment. Want me to read it, or everyone familiar with it?
I'm just reading it again.
Yeah, every person who is elected or appointed to an office or as a member of a multiple member, here's the multiple member body, shall receive a certificate of that election or appointment from the city clerk, town clerk. Let's change that to town clerk. Except as otherwise provided by law, every person who is elected or appointed to an office or as a member of a multiple member body before performing any act under this election or appointment shall take and subscribe to an oath or affirmation to qualify to enter upon the duties. A record of this oath or affirmation shall be kept by the town clerk. We have similar processes right now.
Yeah. Which are, in our current environment, are late in coming. When you're elected or appointed, you have to go down to the clerk's office. And
yes.
You have
yes.
to sign a book. Mm-hmm. But the actual registration, the card that you get, could take several weeks before it's assigned to you.
I've never got a card.
Yeah, exactly. So I just have an issue with that before performing any act under this election.
Right.
For whatever reason outside of that person's control, maybe that card isn't issued.
But how about...
But they're still elected.
You're elected. You go down, you take your oath of office, and at that time the clerk writes out your card and hands it to you.
That's
part
process.
Of his duty, and I believe that's what this is saying. You can't even work until you get that certification.
As long as that process is followed, sure.
Well, again, this is, you know, we're memorializing it here.
It's
there a motion to accept this one?
I'll second.
Okay, any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed.
That time of day.
Limitation on office holding. Unless otherwise allowed by law or this charter, no person shall simultaneously hold more than one town office or position, or position of employment. This section may be waived by the town manager upon appointment of a city to an additional office or position of employment by filing a notice of the waiver with an explanation and justification with the town clerk.
So we had discussion.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we decided against it.
Right.
So let's... Okay. Grab me before I say it, read it.
But you were on a roll, Donna, you know.
This should be common sense, but I don't know what it is. Should there be some language in there about holding two positions in accordance with the conflict of interest laws?
I mean, the state pretty much controls it.
Yeah.
Conflict of interest is already covered.
Know that conflict of interest. Mm-hmm. And I think we've had...
We did some research on it just to make sure if people were going to simultaneously be on the town council and be an employee or something like that.
I think Larry weighed in on that.
Right, the only exclusion was town council and school.
Being on both simultaneously.
Right. Mm-hmm. I believe that was the only board.
No. I'm talking about positions in general. Mm-hmm. I'm not talking about specifically town council and being an employee or town council and...
You mean like being named a police officer and then being named a firefighter? Or are you just talking about one board?
I'll give you an example. So at one point, the question came to me as to whether I'd be willing to serve as interim town administrator. Mm-hmm. at first, it sounded great. Until I called the Ethics Commission and said, oh, by the way, I was recently elected to the Charter Commission and I chair the Appropriations Committee. And they said,
too much.
Everywhere.
Can't do it, you know, and that you would have to actually resign both of those positions to take the, or and then he went into this long explanation of these other things that could occur, which was like, forget it. The point I'm making is, should we have some language, not this language, but should there be some language in there about that they can hold more than one position, so as long as
they clear it?
It's allowed under the Massachusetts laws of ethics or something along that line.
I don't think we need that. I think, I mean, none of this would be sitting here if we only could hold one post. Think about that. Okay, I've served on as many as 3 or 4 different boards in this town simultaneously over the years. A lot of people do. It's partially due to the limited interest in serving on boards. But I don't think we need the provision at all. If it's covered by the Mass Conflict of Interest law, then it's covered. It's already covered. We don't have to put that in the chart.
Okay,
yeah,
I agree.
Yep.
Okay, so next, felony conviction.
Move to accept.
Second.
Discussion?
Hold on. While holding office.
Are you holding
something
from us?
No, what I'm at, what my question would be is...
What'd you do last night?
Felony conviction for anything, for elected, for something in the town?
Anything.
Any felony.
Mm-hmm.
Felony is pretty bad.
It is.
Not a misdemeanor. This is a felony.
In Massachusetts, a felony conviction is commonly referred to as Mrs. Baker. Murder, rape, sodomy, burglary, arson, kidnapping, escape, and robbery.
Pretty good.
That was the criminal.
Wow.
Yeah.
Can you name the King of England's Henry's wife? I'm just thinking.
No. So those things are, you know.
That's pretty serious stuff.
Yeah, that's heavy duty stuff.
Well,
and election
what came
fraud.
To mind a vehicular homicide accident or something like that, which is a felony, occurred when you were 17 years old and you're now 38 years old and
Although
you want to get
a
that doesn't say that.
It says
while
holding
office.
So it happens while you're in office.
Yes.
That, okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
And
clear?
As in many, many governments in this lovely union that we have, if you are a felon and you run for office and they elect you anyway, that starts things over again.
Yeah.
And it happens all the time.
It has.
We are a very forgiving society.
Well,
I
know, and that's
memories.
What's in the back of my head,
but
we're a forgiving society, but
this speaks
but you're
to
right, it speaks
elected.
Strictly while holding office.
Right.
Yes. Okay.
So
a
legal question, should it not just be restricted to conviction? Because there are other ways of there being a guilty verdict, if you will, that is not a conviction. For example, pleading to facts sufficient.
Then it's not the same thing.
Huh?
Not the same thing.
So if somebody committed a fraud while holding office, pled to the facts, got his sentence, he could remain in office.
Well, if it was something, I'm sure, related to his or her official duties, I have to imagine the sentence would include things like you can't hold public office.
What if it's not? What is the intent of this? The intent of this is you don't want the
felon.
The felon who performs a felonious act while holding the office, you don't want him to remain in that office. That's the whole intent of this.
Yeah.
So if they go through a process that is something other than a conviction, it's okay if they hold the office?
They're not guilty.
If they're not guilty, yes.
In this country, you are innocent until proven guilty.
Yeah, it's pretty rare.
See, so this wasn't as simple as what it sounded, okay?
Right.
It's really not. That's,
well, you do have the other safeguards in place, too, assuming this is someone on a board or even it's the town manager. The only thing is if it was someone in the town council.
Or the school committee.
Or a school committee. And then hopefully we've got our recall
procedures
in place.
Shortly, so. And that would provide one more method to remove.
I like the language the way it's written.
It's simple and it's,
So hearing that, and we've had a motion and a second. Any further new discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. Enforcement of charter?
We think this one's kind of goofy.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay, everyone comfortable with?
So then the last one, I believe, is uniform procedures applicable to multiple member bodies.
And we did pass some language with that multiple member body thing.
Enforcement of charter provisions. Did we deal with that one already?
We suggest that I've never been a particular fan of this one, but, and it's not in that many. Do you want to?
No, have we agreed to drop that one?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Sorry. Eric was talking.
It was so quick.
We're on page 3.
Okay, good.
Bottom, uniform procedures applicable to multiple member bodies. Which basically is stating what the title does, correct? That they're, it's stating kind of the obvious, but makes it clear.
There's a typo there in the first sentence. And it's made by ordinance or ordinance, it just should say it's made by bylaw.
My only question on this one is rules and journals. Is a journal different from minutes?
That's the last sentence in the.
No, the middle paragraph.
Yeah, it's the title of the middle paragraph as well as in there. I don't know.
These rules and journals.
You guys don't have journals in this town.
No, it's minutes.
we could replace that with minutes.
That may be. Antiquated language from a couple decades ago from, that is still lingering in various charters that no one's cleaned
up.
So
we changed that to minutes.
Well, but I think, and I can't swear to it, but I thought we've used journals elsewhere as it relates to the clerk's documenting of things in the journal, particularly as it relates to the actions of the council, I think. George, you read it.
I don't recall.
Yeah, here we go. We do have it. It's actually page 5, the bottom page 5 of the draft charter. And it does say the town clerk shall give notice of all council meetings to its members and to the public, maintain a journal of all council proceedings, and yada, yada.
So journal is minutes.
And then we also have it again, all votes on regular and emergency ordinances, although that's going to be bylaws, shall be taken by roll call and shall be recorded in the journal. Now, we could amend these earlier ones if we want this all to reflect
but
minutes.
I would recommend that we
be common
replace
to
journal with minutes everywhere.
Yeah.
Either that or just define journal. So that if it does appear in several locations.
Just
journal
style, whatever.
Be multiple minutes of the different meetings.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
You keep, you keep 3 months worth in one place, it becomes a journal where each individual one is the minutes of the meeting.
I'm not, to me, a journal means a bound copy of some kind. Okay, we don't.
Yeah, I mean, you can define it to be whatever you want it to be if we put it in the definition section.
Yeah.
So it just depends on.
It's a style question.
Yeah.
Okay.
Most of them still appear to use journal, but I suspect it's a relic of.
So it's a full, it's going to be defined as minutes or something.
So to the meat and potatoes of
actions,
this,
recordings.
Do we like it? Yes?
I just have by written notice delivered in hand, have we decided exactly or in the place of residence? So. Have we come up with an agreement of what's delivered in hand?
Where are you reading that?
Middle of the first
special
paragraph.
Meetings of any multiple member body shall be held subject to the call of the chair or by 1/3 of the members thereof by written notice delivered in hand or in the place of residence of each member and which contains a list of items to be acted upon.
Now we could put by personal notice there, and then since we're waiting to define personal notice.
Yeah, right.
It could be something like this.
I think that's a great idea.
Love that.
I might think I read these.
Anything else on language in this? Hearing none, do we want to move on it? Looking at someone?
So moved.
Second.
We have a second. And this is by the amended version, correct? Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Now, it is now 1:05. When we originally set up this meeting, we had talked about going from 9 till 1.
About 9 to 2.
I thought 9 to 2.
So I must have misheard it. Okay, very good.
I remember distinctly saying 5 hours.
Yeah.
Okay.
Somebody may have added wrong.
So, we are done with our general provisions. Impressive.
Very nice.
Now, nominations, elections, initiative, and referendum article. I will let Mike talk, and they also did a lovely spreadsheet so that we can pick and choose.
So there's going to be, at the beginning here, about a half dozen general elections related things, some of which I think are pretty straightforward, a couple of which there's some major decision points, mostly about preliminary election. And then after that, we will go in through these four initiative, referendum, free petition, and recall, and then there's some tie-up at the end. So just to kind of walk you through this, you'll see on page one, the first one is stating when the election is going to be. I think we already decided
June.
Right? Mm-hmm. So we can fill that in, and as I don't think there needs to be any major discussion on that.
Although, how'd you pick the 7th Tuesday proceeding?
On the 7th Tuesday proceeding.
For the primary.
Well, so
that's a decision point.
Yeah. Why don't we quickly deal with this next partisan elections piece, because I think that's probably straightforward,
and then we'll
come to the whole preliminary election.
Okay.
Well, wait a minute.
Tie it back to that.
Right. We're doing the partisan elections, elections for town offices shall be nonpartisan, and election ballots shall be printed without any party mark, emblem, or other designation whatsoever, which is reflective of what we have now.
Correct.
We're nonpartisan.
Move to accept that language.
Second.
Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Very good. So we're back to...
Okay. So now the main decision point here is, do you want to have preliminary elections or not? These would be nonpartisan, so it would be a primary per se, but it would winnow the number, you know, have two elections, to one to winnow the number down, and then two to decide, or is it all in one?
No.
It's all in one?
No.
Well, if you think about it, our council is a 7-member, so there's going to be 2 members elected. So what are you going to whittle it down to? I mean, how many people do you think are going to run? 6?
Well, that doesn't matter. You have to go at it thinking more positive than how many are going to run.
Okay, well, I mean, let's say there's 10 that are running.
Yeah, 10 run, you whittle it down to 4.
Right.
I don't...
And if you don't have enough people running,
you
cancel the primary.
It.
It's been done before.
Just the way it is now.
Yeah.
We have a preliminary election right now?
Yeah.
Yes.
We have a primary. Yeah.
We have had.
Well, it's not always real. Heck, usually we don't have enough people.
I went back through and I saw how many candidates were running for each position over the last 10 years. When have we used a preliminary election?
3 years ago.
Yeah, we have.
3 years ago.
We have in certain cases. What happens is in our current, I believe it's in our current bylaws, we have one position, we have more than 2 candidates, greater than 2.
Yeah.
We have to have a preliminary runoff to get down to 2.
It happened 3 years ago.
Yeah, this is really...
It's rare.
This is one you have to hold on to.
Yeah, yeah, I think you have to have, the opportunity has to be there, or in the oddity that it comes up. The option has to be left there.
But I would like to see, if we do include the preliminary, I'd like to see it written in reverse, that instead of saying that we will hold a preliminary election, saying that we'll hold an election, and if there are more candidates than two for each position, then we would hold a preliminary.
That's fine.
I'm torn. I don't know. I think if, let's take council as an example. Yeah. If there's three candidates vying for the one seat, is that a bad thing?
But you're always going
to have. I understand if you got 10. Yeah. I don't know. I just.
Well, you're always going to have two. Well, you're always going to have two seats up. So if you have three candidates, it won't matter because it's the highest right. two vote getters. You would have to go to four.
Okay. So greater. Then if we had five
yes.
candidates, would that be a bad thing? For well, two I, seats.
I think because we're proposing an awful lot of changes here, I think some things we should just, because it's going to be a rare occasion, we just leave the option there.
There's nothing well, in our current bylaw.
It's not an option, though, is it?
Well, because you don't have to have them. I mean, you're not going to have them every year.
No, no, right. But if you require them, you require them.
Yeah, but I still like leaving it there. Because
there's nothing in our current bylaw that requires a preliminary, so I'm wondering if that's state law.
Could be state law.
March?
Because our bylaw does not address that at all. It doesn't provide for any kind of preliminary election.
No.
It simply says that the election of town officers shall be held on the second Tuesday in April.
Right.
That's all it says.
Then it's got to be state law.
That's why, I mean, I was looking, and I couldn't remember back to when we ran a preliminary election
3 years
to
ago.
Whittle it down.
What?
And what was that for? Was it?
We had three or four candidates at the time.
There was an election in March and another one in April.
In the appendix, you'll look at that here. What act would it be?
I don't know.
Just out of curiosity, on the council, if we have two members running, let's say Eric and George are council members that are running, I'm going to run against them. Do I have to designate that I'm running for that seat
no.
or that?
Top
because
two
it's at large. So.
Just the way it is now.
And that's exactly what I'm saying. So why have a preliminary if it's just the top two vote getters?
Well,
I mean, I just don't see us getting 10 people to run for two seats or 8 people to run for two seats. I see us getting three or four people possibly to run for two seats, and it's the top two vote getters.
Yeah. You can't.
Yes, March.
Is there different terms of the years, then they have to specify which term they want.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, because it can become a very strategic thing for the
candidate.
Is.
Yeah, it could be.
But after the initial setup of the, well, no, I suppose it could be different if somebody vacated.
If somebody vacates.
Then
you have to designate.
Okay. Yeah.
So let's just, I hate to use this as an example, but you have 14 Republican candidates.
But
it's nonpartisan.
Not partisan.
I know that, but they got to whittle it down. I mean, this is a way to kind of whittle it down so that the final group, that the voters can focus more on those individuals who've gone to the next step and focus on their platforms and their opinions. And
so what are we going to whittle it down to? If there's two seats available, no more than four people running?
Not four.
Yeah.
It's usually double the number.
Right.
Yeah, it is double.
Are you trying to tell us that there's 13 more of you in town?
Yeah, I think there's some sitting around the table.
I was going to let that one go.
What if you were just to hold an election and say if you had the 14 people running, if two of them receive more than 50% of the vote that they're elected, if you don't receive more than 50% of the vote, then you have a runoff.
I don't think anyone would get 50%, because that's a huge chunk.
If there's 14 people running.
Well, forget that, because you know very well we're not going to get 14 people to run for any position here. But if you have five people running for the two seats on the select board or the council, you're voting for two people. So if you can get 50% of the vote, if two of those five people get 50% of the vote, put them in office.
Yeah. But if you're doing it as a preliminary election and they happen to receive 50% of the vote, there's going to be a lot of people that don't come out to vote at the preliminary. I'm not going to vote then.
Yeah.
Marge has, do you have additional insight?
I think the state covers the preliminary
and we can do some research if we want to, you know, table this. We can find out if that's automatic, whether we put it in or not. We can look that up.
Well, the other question I had for you was the first sentence in there. The regular general town election shall be held in the first Tuesday following the first Monday in, and we would
June,
but in each odd-numbered year?
That was your buy-in.
Each year.
Bad cut of these there.
And there's another place further in here that
says
biannual, which is for each year. So do we want to... Okay, I'm sorry.
Like I said, I never really realized that we had preliminary elections. I'm not against a preliminary election. Never really saw a need for us to hold another election in town. If you have five people running for two positions, you're going to narrow it down to four. So now you're paying.
It's costing the town money.
Yeah.
It's democracy.
Yeah.
Well, but why is it not democracy if all five go to the general election?
So sometimes tradition trumps all else. And really, I would like to think that this whole thing that we're going through might actually promote more interest in people being involved in the town. And that might be a wonderful problem to have. So
I like to think so, but we'll see.
So we're going to circle back.
Yes.
Okay.
Sound good?
Yep.
And we'll find out whether that preliminary elections, if they're actually required by the state.
So we'll also skip over that.
Well, there are a couple pieces within this we still might be able to tackle here.
Okay.
So signature requirements. So if I could, still on that first page, the number of signatures of voters required to place the name of a candidate on the official ballot used at, and it would depend, bracket per preliminary or election, shall be as follows: for the office of town council and member of school committee, not less than, you can blank, delete 100 until you've decided, such signature, and delete the last, then not more than 50.
Right.
Well, right now it's 50. So
50.
Right. Leave it that
way. Yeah.
Let's just leave it that way.
Okay. Ballot position. There are multiple ways to do it. I think the most common is drawing by lot, but
that's
alphabetical.
I like drawing by lot.
I do too.
I know it's someone with an S.
Yeah, I've been W my whole life, and when you're at the end, you get forgotten.
Yeah,
I do.
That's right.
You do.
I don't know if that's a decision we can make. I think that might be under state, because whenever we get the ballots back that are printed, they're always in alphabetical order by the state.
No, I think
you can decide it in the charter. We can rule by lot. Yeah.
Okay.
The Board of Election Commissioners. Do we have such a board, or are we establishing something new?
Probably registrar.
Right now they're registrars.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So not to check the
registrar. Okay.
So are people good with that for ballot positions?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So. We can skip over the rest of this on page two is preliminary, and then we can skip over ballot position regular, because that will depend, affected by the preliminary. But districts we are not using, so that can be knocked out. And then the last piece here is just a, this is a catch-all, you know, state law is covering it for the elections, just so everyone is clear that that's what's, everyone, meaning the public, knows where to look for election law.
Right.
Any questions on that?
No.
Okay.
Do we need motions on everything we just discussed, or are we?
I would like that, just so we can knock it off.
Yeah.
So I make a motion that we just accept the language that Mike just reviewed with us.
Second. Application of state general laws.
Preliminary under
first or second.
Ballot position.
Signature requirement, ballot position.
Yep.
Okay.
And well, we don't have to.
We'll leave it at that for now.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah.
While an application of state general laws.
I was going to do that as a separate one because it's a separate category.
So we are,
yep.
Yours is signature requirement, ballot position, and application of state general laws, correct?
Okay.
And there was a second. Discussion? Hearing no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Lead on.
So we have three major and one, I would say, minor, what are often called citizen relief mechanisms here. Although I should say that the minor one, I does not look like we got it in. I'm sorry about that into the document here. But we can talk through it and decide if we want it. I honestly think the other three are much more important and consequential to discuss. So the and those are initiative, petition, referendum, and recall. The structure of these is, of all three of these, is similar. The language is lifted from a recently passed charter, because these get very technical and legal and whip of my head quickly. So I strongly recommend basically as few changes to the text as possible, assuming you want any of these. And really, you'll, as you go through, you'll see question mark, bracket, question mark. Those are the key decision points. How many signatures or what percent of voters? How long does council have to review? Do you want to do a second round of signatures? Things like that. So, you know, we can take them. I mean, we suppose we could start off with initiative and then, and first, you know, discuss, is this something you want? And then referendum and recall. And then either we can save free petition for next time or decide if, but.
You want me to cut and paste it?
Yeah.
So why is the school committee in here? It says petition with the town clerk or the secretary of the school committee.
Because you can you can do an initiative petition to the school committee for action.
Or you don't have to have that in here, I suppose.
That's
we
that's
could
true.
Take
I'm
all
trying to think,
references
I'm
to
trying
the
to think
video.
What, like what issue could you take?
So anything that the school committee votes
yeah.
on.
If a citizen wanted to initiate
like
something in
yeah.
for school related,
like
rather
what?
Than
budget,
no
anything.
Budget exempt.
Yeah,
was
budget,
listed,
yeah, budget
is
exempt in this.
But then what else?
Budget
policy.
Yeah,
policy.
Some policy saying, you know,
yeah.
we want German to be added to the middle school languages, or something. I don't know.
Yeah, but then that would fall under budget.
Or we
well,
want the women to wear white and the boys to wear red. On their
well, go there
we
again?
Haven't been there yet.
I don't think there's any harm in leaving it in there.
All right.
Through the chair.
Yes.
Mike, can I ask a couple questions? I'm looking at Randolph's, and there's section 7.6, petitions to council or school committee. And then under 7.7, it says citizens' initiative measures. What's the difference between a petition to a council and a citizen initiative measure?
So let me just make sure we got Randolph here. Let me make sure I'm
yep.
they're using them in the same way.
I printed out page 22, section 7-6.
So. Petition, so free petition appears to be like free petition here, which is basically saying, we want to put this issue in front of you and make you discuss it. Whereas initiative is saying, this is, you know, this is going to be the bylaw, the ordinance. This is going to be the...
Meaning the citizens craft the language, and it's a yes or no, versus saying, you're the school committee, and you craft the language.
Right, yeah, you're required to look at this, but you really can do whatever you want, versus this is what you're going to do,
I mean, 'cause it's,
or this is what's going to happen.
There's 150 signatures required for just a petition, 250 required for initiative.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I read through it, and I'm like, wait a minute, what would I use this for and not this? And
yeah, well, one obviously is a little simpler,
to get something in front of them.
Yeah, to get it moving.
Wouldn't you just pull a counselor aside and say, geez, you guys should think about this?
No, you got to go through this process.
Well, in theory, you're right. A counselor, you know, if they're attuned and listening, a school committee member, a counselor should say, oh, yeah, I've heard a couple people talk about this. We should probably bring this issue to council. This is, all of these should be looked at as recourse for the public when the
right.
council
yes.
or school
right.
committee is not doing
responsive.
Yeah,
right.
and
right.
So, you know, three of us keep going to the different town councilors and saying, we did look at this, and they never do. Okay, well, we're getting to get in the case of the free petition, we're getting together. And saying, okay, we have put this on your agenda, so you have to deal with it. Or in the case of the initiative, we're just going to go around and do it ourselves.
Well, would that be?
Yeah.
My sense is, Michael, I don't know if I'm right, I don't mean to interrupt, mm-hmm. but that an initiative, typically initiative petition, would put it on a ballot at a town election
mm-hmm.
and basically bypass the
correct
town council.
Yeah.
Whereas
that's a
better
way. That's a better way of putting it.
Yeah. That's a good, clear way.
Yeah, that is good.
Yeah.
Well, but then, I mean, you can take one action before the other.
Right.
Right?
Well,
you can,
mm-hmm.
I mean, here we're referring to is the referendum procedure. Yes? Am I correct?
So referendum is a third
different.
Thing altogether.
Right.
Referendum is when the council or school committee passes something. And the public says no way and gathers signatures and shuts it down.
Oh, I see. I read it also. It could be if the council rejects something and the citizens say, what?
I think that would, I mean, it's 6-1 have to, it's
right,
you can
okay.
still do it either way. I think that would fall under.
If a citizen initiative measure was brought forward
mm-hmm.
and the council voted it down, for example.
So if they
could go to a referendum.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. So that's
exactly
what you're saying. That's the difference between the free petition and the initiative petition. The free
okay.
petition. So maybe we should walk through all this. A free petition. We the public have come forward and said, put this on your agenda. We want you to vote on this, and the council votes on it and turns it down.
Mm-hmm.
So then we say, okay, no, we're going to put this on the ballot ourselves
mm-hmm.
and do the initiative. And do that, and then another issue comes up, and the council votes on it. We, the public, don't like that, so we go do a referendum on what they just passed and try and undo it.
Okay.
And then lastly, we don't like anything that they've done at all, and so now we're going to just recall a bunch of them and pull them back.
But that was very well stated, what
yeah.
you just
yeah.
did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank
yeah.
you. Took me a while to get around
no,
to
no,
it.
No,
it was
yeah.
very good.
Yeah.
So we need to fill in the blanks of
yeah.
the boilerplate language.
Sure.
Well, do you want them to be the first question.
Absolutely.
All four of them.
Yes.
Sweeping every
yes.
general.
Yes.
Yes.
All
yes.
the
some
options. Pick and choose. Some say, well, we want, you know, recall and...
Well, I think the reason we want all of them is we are going away from town meeting.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
We heard it's a public hearing.
Mm-hmm.
Our voices can't be heard.
Mm-hmm.
We have to make sure there's an opportunity for people's voices
yeah.
to be heard.
Right.
Yeah.
Is there an opportunity here, too, to put these in the definition section, since a lot of us seem...
Sure.
I'm sure as to how it all falls.
That's
yes.
good.
That
good
would help
point.
Out.
Yeah.
I
point.
Like that.
Good
mm-hmm.
point.
Yeah, that's a, actually
yeah.
a really good suggestion.
And I, it occurs to me, I should have brought along, I do have a document that provides some definitions, even a little historical background about, you know, the frequency, because some of these are used, you know, relatively frequently. I think recall and well, maybe recall may be the most frequent. Free petition is, I think, very rare, and then the other two kind of in the middle. But I want to let me bring for the next or send to you to, so you have for the next meeting some a little more background on each of those.
Does anybody have a spare printed copy of this? My battery's down to 5%.
Here, I'll do my usual. I'll share with Ralph, or he'll share with me.
Oh, I've got it.
What a guy.
Less than a photocopy of device.
Is that one in the back of the room?
That looks like a printer.
That's just a printer.
That's not a printer copier.
All right. Thanks.
Should be.
Russ.
All right.
So in order of, so I think on the number of signatures, there we should give consideration in the impact that each has, and therefore make the number of signatures higher based upon
as
the
we
level,
go up. As we go up the ladder.
Agree. And this is always a very challenging piece of this and very important, growing more important with each successive step, because you want to make it possible, feasible for these to be done. Otherwise, why even put them in? But you don't want to make it easy because it can be very disruptive, especially recall. We've seen some towns get just caught in the successive loop of recalls because it's too easy, and it so that you know finding your sweet spot for each of these is kind of the trick.
So you just kind of did the pecking order.
Mm-hmm.
So the first one would be.
The first one would be the free petition, which we actually don't have. That's the one that's missing from this.
But the free
document.
Petition is to ask the town council to put something on their agenda and to vote on.
Mm-hmm. Like so. What Randolph has.
So
the petition to council or school committee.
Yeah.
And if you've got your, I don't know if everyone's got that Excel chart too, so you can see what other municipalities have done. So sort of the range of number of voters or percentage of voters.
So yeah, well, you want me to, or do you want to read it, or I can read out the Randolph?
You can read it. You got it. Would you like it here?
7-6
7-6
Petitions to the council or school committee. The town council or the school committee shall hold a public hearing and act with respect to every petition which is addressed to it, which is signed by 150 voters or more, and which seeks the passage of a measure. The hearing shall be held by the town council or school committee, or in either case by a committee or subcommittee thereof, and the action by the town council or the school committee shall be taken not later than 3 months after the petition is filed with the clerk of the council or the administrative assistant to the superintendent as may be appropriate. Hearings on two or more petitions filed under the section may be held at the same place, time and place. The clerk of the council or the administrative assistant to the superintendent shall mail notice of the hearing to the 10 persons whose names appear first in the petition at least 48 hours before the hearing. Notice by publication of all such hearings shall be at the public expense.
I like it.
I like that with the exception of should be superintendent shall mail notice of the hearing to the 10 persons whose names appear first on the petition at least 48 hours. Well, if you mail something 48 hours, they're never going to receive it.
I agree with that.
Well, maybe we should yet again put personal notice.
But how will they do that? Because they may not know.
Oh, you're right. They might not have
it. They may not.
So okay, seven,
they
might 7 days.
7 days.
7 days.
Okay, so we're using Randolph, but with 7 days.
Now, could you, in the very beginning, did we specify how many?
Not yet, no.
Okay.
So you'll see on that spreadsheet I gave you,
150.
The average is
150 is a pretty common number for that.
Yep. Looks good to me.
Winthrop makes me nervous with just 50 voters.
That's scary.
Yeah, it could be every meeting.
It could be every meeting is
well,
right.
I mean, typically right now, if you do a petition for a zone change or something like that, to annual town meeting is only 10 voters have to sign it. At a special town meeting is 100. So, I mean, and that's what we have right now. I mean,
ten
voters at annual town meeting, I mean, that's...
10 is way too few.
It is.
Yeah, it is.
Way too few.
But you say that, but how many do we actually have come in front of us? We don't have a heck of a lot.
But this might change everything up.
Registered voters?
This, because you're talking about a voice being heard, it might change it up.
I mean, 11,040.
Registered voters?
Yeah. Something like that, Marge? I believe the last number. What was it?
10,500?
I still like the last count. I like the 150.
So what does that come out to as a percentage? I like using percentages.
Well, because it could move that with the growth or loss.
1.4%, it looks like. 150 out of 10,000.
One, drop it to 1%.
So 105 voters.
And this is just a petition just to say, hey, we'd like you to look at this. They don't have to do anything, so.
Well, they do have to act on it, but.
They've got to act, but that's not.
They don't have to adopt it.
Exactly. It's just, hey, we want this in front of you to consider. I mean, my thought would be 100 would be more than sufficient, because I really don't think you're going to be bringing a lot of them. I think if something's that important, they're going to skip right over this and they're going to go to an initiative.
The only thing I would recommend it is if we are going to use hard numbers throughout this document or percentages, that we keep it consistent.
Oh, we will.
I would use hard numbers.
I would use hard numbers.
Hard numbers, 100.
Yeah.
Because if you're using percentages, it's going to be changing constantly every year.
All the way through this.
This section.
Yes.
Hard numbers for this section.
Yeah.
All right.
Rather than percentages?
Right.
And so for the first one, I'd say 100.
Yeah.
I'm fine with that. I was just going to say, if we're going to use percentages elsewhere, let's convert that to a percentage and use that.
So hearing that, could someone move to?
I would make a motion that we adopt the section in Randolph 7.6, petitions to council or school committee, with the amendment 100 voters and 7 days notice mailed.
To the first 10 petitioners.
To the first 10 petitioners. And
discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Just out of curiosity, how do you determine the first 10?
How they're signed on the petition is the first 10 names.
And you got
when they sent.
You got 4 sheets?
It's whatever one is on the top.
On the top. They have to.
Discretionary.
It was spelled out somewhere, I read, that it has to be submitted, stapled together. Where did I read that?
There's probably in regulations.
Yes, in these, that's what it states. Somewhere I read that they have to all be submitted at the same time.
Yeah. Right, and it's stapled that they have to be, you know, it tells
there's
how
a
it
process,
has to be submitted so that you can tell that, right?
Okay. Well, there's something there, because otherwise, you know, they can pick and choose the 10 that they send to.
I read it somewhere.
Yeah, the person organizing the whole thing should pretty much take charge of all that.
Absolutely.
You would hope so.
You know,
Yeah, it does say if we're going to, we could even put some of this language from the next section, the citizen initiative measures, paragraph C, it does say,
submission,
that signatures to initiative petition need not all be on one paper, but all papers pertaining to any one measure shall be fastened together and shall be filed as a single instrument. Yeah. So you can imagine whatever's.
Mm-hmm. So do we need a motion then to attach that to the one that we just adopted?
Well, if you'd like us, when we go back, I just want to make sure that these are uniform throughout. Yeah, I can make sure any language either pertains to it all or,
Answers that concern.
Yeah.
Because the petitions no matter how you hand in those petitions, should be the same fashion.
Sure.
But if you've got one person or just 3 or 4 people organizing, I think they'll follow the letter of the law.
Yeah, I agree.
And make sure that everything is done properly.
Good luck.
All right, so next would be the next.
So there's one last little, I want to confirm. I mean, you just approved the whole language, but the other decision point was the number of months that the committee has to respond. It says 3 in there. Most of the ones that we, of the group that we collected that have it, are 3. Bridgewater is the outlier with a 2-month window, but if we just leave it, I mean, you voted it, is that sufficient? Or do you want to?
Yeah, I think
3 is fine.
And that's what we voted on, 3?
Yes.
So, I think that's sufficient.
Okay, very good. So the next one, citizen initiative measures. So herein we start winding into the kind of convoluted legal language, but so if you look in that first paragraph about commencement, it says on page 3, this sort of lays out how it gets started, and the first decision point you have is about 5 lines down. I guess I'll read that whole sentence. The petition shall be addressed to town council or the school committee, shall contain a request for the passage of a particular measure which shall be set forth in full in the petition and shall be signed by qualified voters of the town equal in number to not fewer than blank of those registered at the last town election.
That's probably a percentage.
If you look on the spreadsheet that we provided, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of them do it by percent, 2 do it by hard numbers. For this, those that do it by percent, it's either 5 or 10%, and then the others are 50 votes each. Now, just so you know, so what you know, the way it gets, so assuming you get the percent you need, it goes to council. Well, first, let's see, it gets, everything has to get approved. Then the town council, not the attorney, has time to actually act on it. They're given like a, okay, so this is there was a warning shot. This is coming if you don't do something about it. And so they have time. And then if they don't act or if they reject it, then you have to go back, the group goes back and collects additional signatures within a time frame. If they collect those, then it goes on the ballot. And then the last sort of decision point here is, do you have a floor number of voters that have to show up to make it work? And you'll see that a bunch of them do set in a percent of voters. So that's basically, you know, how this plays out. If you want, we can kind of walk through one by the...
So what's 5% of 11,000?
It's a lot.
Yeah.
It's a lot.
2,200?
Yeah, which is higher than what we have to collect.
No.
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 5%, sorry, it's like 20%.
Yeah.
It's like,
I mean,
but we just said we were going to go through hard numbers.
Right.
That was for that
percentage.
Section.
Yeah.
So this is kind of estimating.
Yeah, this
yeah.
Is
that's
right.
What I meant was that through
so 500 is a good number.
500 is a good number, yeah.
But to start it, like you said, if you put 200 initial,
right,
then the town council looks at it. Then you go, okay, we're going to go forwards with this. Then I would say jump it up to 500.
That's fine.
Mm-hmm. Or an additional, yeah.
Yeah, an additional. Is it additional or is it a total of 500?
No,
can the same people
over,
sign
yeah.
it?
It depends. I mean, different municipalities have it
well,
different ways.
And
yeah.
I've read multiple.
No, I really
so you
think,
can do what you want.
I think we should do 200 to get it rolling. But once it's rolling, I think you only need another 300 for a total of 500. I think it's mean to then all of a sudden
just
say
start
you got to start
over.
All over again.
Okay.
That to me.
Yeah. Well, you would hope the message gets
well,
taken by
you're
the
not
first.
Not starting all over again. It's gone before at that point. It's gone before the council had been rejected.
Yeah.
I'm assuming and hopefully for good reason. So if it's essentially the voters now have the opportunity to override the council,
mm-hmm.
I think it should require a big number.
Yeah,
at that point, it should, and that helps narrow the special interest.
Why
so I don't think 500
well,
is out of the
well,
question
he's
at all.
He's saying 500. He just says the first 200.
No,
he's
saying
why he's saying the first 200 for the first part count.
Right.
Count toward the 500.
And right.
Yeah.
I don't
so
know.
So you're looking at 300 additional. Oh, because otherwise you're just getting the first 200 to sign it again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
well,
make sense.
Assuming no changes are made, sure.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Right, well, they're doing this if no change. If the council
right.
adopts it,
then
they're
right.
not going to be doing
away.
This.
Yeah.
It
goes away.
But I guess I just, I feel like it should be done in such a manner that prevents.
Well, you're doubling the number of people who.
More than
doubling the number of people who
okay.
want to join on to that initiative.
So do we want to go, let's go point by point and fill in the blanks then. That makes sense
yeah.
Yeah.
to everyone? So.
All right, so...
I can't read anymore.
Shall be signed by qualified voters of the town, and then if you're doing percent equal a number to, but if you're just doing a hard number, then you could just say, and shall be signed by...
200.
200.
Not fewer than 200. And then we'll take out the next sentence regarding precinct.
Right.
And then I think we get 200 again in the next one.
Yes.
By 200. Okay, so let's, that's in section A.
Right.
So we've got 200, 200. I'd like to have a motion on that.
An additional 300.
So moved.
Yeah, that'll come right in.
Discussion?
Are we done with the whole paragraph?
We're done with the first.
Yes, we're filling in the blanks of section A, and we've agreed on to amendment, removed that sentence about precinct.
Okay.
Clear? Sound good? Eric?
Oh, yeah, the petitioners committee.
Okay, never mind. 200 certified signatures.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, never mind. I just wanted to clarify that.
All right, so we've got the motion, discussion, hearing none. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Nay. Motion passes. Now, we are on the next referral to town council. Within, we need to fill in how many days?
15, or 14 days. So I just, in my past life doing town council work in Greenfield, I'm very familiar with these. You go much further than that, all hell will break loose with the citizens.
Yeah.
It shouldn't take them more than 2 weeks to determine the legality of it all.
Other places do have 20 to 30, but, you know.
That would be a low outlier.
You're still...
Yeah, like 14.
Then 21 days.
21?
21.
So would you move that, please?
I move 21 days.
Second.
One question. Does typically the school committee employ council other than town council?
Yes.
So should we incorporate town council, or in the case of the school committee?
School council.
School council?
Yeah, but is your school council for your labor matters, or all things?
We have two, special education. We have a separate special education.
And then you have labor.
And labor.
Yeah, so I...
But labor does school law also.
Yeah, but this isn't school law. This is really...
No, this is not.
Yeah, this is town council.
It is town council.
Okay.
Okay.
So, any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed?
Did we just...
Carries.
Did we just adopt strictly 21 days, or the whole paragraph?
Whole paragraph.
Whole paragraph for 21 days.
Because this is pretty much boilerplate.
Yep.
And advise not to mess with it too much. Section C, submission to town clerk, has a lot of little fill-in-the-blanks here.
The first one is, it's the number of voters who...
That's 200.
So the first one is the first 200, correct? Then the town clerk shall notify the first how many blank number of voters that the blank forms are issued. Should it be the first 10, or do we up it?
No, 10.
10.
10?
Yep.
Sound good by consensus here? Within blank days following the date of the notice, the petition shall be returned and filed with the town clerk, signed by qualified voters of town equal to, in number, to not fewer than blank of those registered at the last town election. So we've got two blanks. First one is within how many days?
Well, that might be dictated by how many people.
So I'm going to say 60.
Yeah.
And by how many people?
500.
Yeah.
Which shall include the original 200.
Right.
Right. You have to have a reasonable amount of time for the number of people required. I think that's reasonable.
So to fill in the blanks, it's 60 and 300. Do you have that, Tanya?
No.
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 500.
60.
Which shall include the original 200.
That's where I was.
Signatory.
Thank you.
Hold on.
I think we actually...
Yeah, I think we're in a different section here, or...
Well, I think I'm...
Or am I?
I think we actually missed, and this is my fault, I'm sorry, I think we missed there's a smaller first step of just kicking the whole thing off that is even prior. So I think the 200 actually belongs where we're talking now, and the 300 belongs in supplementary petitions. Am I...
I
And.
No, we're not there yet.
Or submission to town clerk, are we?
That's what I, yeah, that's what I thought where we were.
Concise summary.
Let me actually, I have an idea.
Determine whether the town council.
I just want to make sure we do it right.
First 200 voters who sign by.
And we, did we, is this the document that we had the update to? No, that was the charter.
That was the full charter.
So.
We've got time.
Make sure.
This is the hardest part, that we have the blank.
It is.
So many, those are the parts.
Yes.
Keep having to reread it, because I keep confusing council with council.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, because why do they need subsequent ones here? I'm sorry, now my mind is a little blown. I'm like, how does this?
Yeah, it's like a step one A and B, and then supplementary is step two, but I'm trying to.
So are you thinking we're missing a step in here?
Yeah, I want to.
Maybe we should stop. We should stop here. Maybe we should stop here.
We want to make sure we get it right.
That's what I'm saying.
So what I would suggest then is you've made the major conceptual decision to do all of these. And so what I would suggest is, you know, you can either talk now or thinking it over, and then talk early at the next meeting of what's the general level of, and you've already got the sum of like difficulty level.
Yeah.
And then we'll confirm that, make sure we've got the right, fill in the blank spots here to connect to with the right numbers. And we'll take care of that.
So why don't you also take a crack at putting in those upper level numbers based upon what we.
Well, what we, you know.
Yeah.
Two at the first stage, five at the second.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Those kind of things, yeah.
Yep.
But let's use hard numbers, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and if we do want to take just one, you know, a minute or two to say what our likely thresholds are for the others, I don't know, for the petition or the recall, if we think we're just kind of step it up for each one of those, or we can just make our best guess and y'all can change it when we come back.
The only other thing I want to add on those numbers is where there's time constraints in there, that the time constraint really needs to be reflective of the numbers that's required, so that it's fair.
We're into that.
You can't say 500 signatures in a week, you know, for example.
Well, you could.
There's sort of three different sets of time windows here. There's the window for signature collection, there's the window for the clerk's office to act, and then there's the window for the council, town council to act. So, you know, those are all going to be interplaying in this. We'll have to just keep those in mind.
But on the recall, so I, you know, I noticed on some of these, they're not, it doesn't appear to be a lot of signatures on some of them, although I don't know the population on some of these towns. But, you know, maybe Marjorie can help me, but we have select people getting elected with how many votes? 800? You know, less.
Last election was 5% of the population voted.
It's 500 people.
Yeah. So it's, although I believe the gravity of the situation and that you're going to undertake to remove a person that was previously elected by the electorate, I don't want to make it so burdensome that it could never take place.
Right.
But it's kind of that magic, do I think 500 is the right number? No. Do I think 2,000 is the right number? No.
It's a delicate balance.
It really is.
Yeah.
Because I really want this to be able to be used, but only in.
Judiciously.
Thank you. Where the situation has just.
Yeah.
Because you don't like somebody is not a reason to recall them.
It can't be a wish.
Exactly.
I mean, there's other means.
Just because you don't like someone doesn't mean that everyone in town doesn't like them.
Right, or they're not capable of doing the job.
And there's also mitigating factors of if they just got elected, you need to give them time to get their feet.
There's that learning curve.
And then at the end, why have a recall when they've got In 3 months.
Well, there was language in there about so soon after being elected.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
But I think the referendum, which you really kind of, you want to go to, you know, to the ballot to overturn something is also a very,
Yes.
You know, I'm trying to step up. That's a lot to do, so.
Yeah, it's important, but it should be a very deliberate act, so the number should reflect that.
Correct. And I would match the referendum and the recall as far as the number of votes.
And put initiative a little below and free below with that?
Yeah.
Okay, so we can make our best guess and then people can.
At least gives us a starting point so we know this is going up the ladder.
And there's one other thing I want to throw in there, which we'll add into this in the next iteration. And this is I alluded to this before. You'll see on the last column in each of these subjects in the spreadsheet is required voter participation, which is to say, you know, could someone, if recall made it to the ballot and only 50 people showed up, is that it? I mean, and those 50 people all said, you're out. Is that it? I mean, or do you need to have 5% of the registered voters or 10%? Ditto with referendum, or, you know, could 3% of the population overturn the council on something? So just things to keep in mind, whether you want to have that threshold or not.
I mean, one of my thoughts on that is if it's going to take you 1,500 votes to get it on the ballot, then at least 1,500 people should have to show up to vote on it.
Yeah.
So if you're using percentages, it's 5%, 5%. I mean, if you get it put on with 1,500 votes and only 100 people show up, that just doesn't, I mean, I would like to see it at least the same number.
Again, it speaks to that delicate balance because you don't, it's a mechanism that has to be there, but it's got to be deliberate to make sure that it's followed properly. So you can't just make it, 500 people, good, we're done.
And
really, I disagree wholeheartedly with you. I mean, an election is this becomes an election, period. So if 100 people show up, that's what shows up.
And bear in mind, there are people with a philosophy that they will sign because they believe in the process. They will sign a petition. Doesn't mean
they're going to show up.
They're not going to show up.
Yeah.
I mean, look what happened. We get, you know, collecting signatures for the charter.
Yeah.
And
it's true. We collected more signatures than showed up.
Yeah. And then 5% of the electorate shows up at the last spring election. So it speaks to that point.
So. A lot of food to think.
Yeah. It goes back to, you can lead them to water, but you can't make them drink.
Yeah.
And we also, next go round would be starting transitions.
Mm-hmm. So how are we doing on our timeline?
Yeah.
Yeah. With the work that we did today.
Here. This was a big deal today.
Got a lot done.
We're still up against.
By the way, I would like to get everyone's feel, but I do not want to meet on Thanksgiving.
Really?
Good point. Yeah. But wait, it might get me out of cooking turkey.
Absolutely, I don't want to meet on Thanksgiving. Won't meet on Thanksgiving. But I do feel the urgency
today.
Yes,
and that's why I asked where we're at.
Yeah, you know,
we're into December very quickly.
We are.
Well, we're into
December.
We're there.
The following week, we're there.
Yeah, I mean, our original timeline had us basically finishing things up at our next meeting, which would have fallen on Thanksgiving. So, you know, take that as you will. If there's going to be another meeting, hopefully we would finish up. I mean, I don't know if we're going to do another Saturday meeting, if it would be long enough to finish up what we've been working on, plus the transition provisions, which are going to be complicated. Mm-hmm. We'll try and put as much together as we can, but obviously that's going to need some crafting.
I think the transitions is going to be
And then we had scheduled from the end of November through the second to last week of December, that was going to be an editing period, and then on the calendar is the preliminary report mailed and published in the paper
the last week of December or the last days of last week of December or the first week in January. So giving us basically the month of December to edit.
So what would everybody think then if we planned?
I'm sorry, and the preliminary submission to the AG also coming at the end of December.
End of December, right. Which is really our big deadline, right?
Exactly.
So what would everybody think of meeting next Thursday the 3rd as planned? And at least tentatively setting the following Saturday to do what we don't get done on that Thursday night. Now, if we have a very productive meeting, I don't see us getting it all done on that Thursday night. I see us having to spend some time on the following Saturday.
Well, so the appropriation, I don't know, who meets on Tuesday nights here? What committees? Because maybe the following Tuesday, appropriations is done for the month of December, right? We're done on the 1st.
Yeah, we are. After the 1st, yeah.
Planning board meets on Tuesdays, alternate Tuesdays.
Are you meeting that
March,
Tuesday?
And March, hang on.
Yeah.
I have a conflict, unfortunately, on Thursday the 3rd.
Okay.
You can proceed.
And I cannot
the other thing
meet
is
up.
For us, when we do the evenings, we're just...
We're there for 2 hours. Yeah, I know.
A couple hours.
I'm fine doing a Saturday again. I have no problem.
I'm not, but I'll do it because we have to get it done.
So are we going to plan on meeting on December 3rd? Well, what were you saying about Tuesdays? Because
he was just thinking we could do Tuesdays.
We could do Thursday followed by Tuesday.
Oh.
But I'm fine doing the Saturday.
Next Saturday?
No.
Not next Saturday.
I'm not around next Saturday.
Not next Saturday.
So if we plan on Thursday the 3rd and Saturday the 5th, if we don't need Saturday the 5th, we'll figure that out on Thursday the 3rd.
Let's see if Mike can get permission.
Well, we still have to post it.
Yeah, well, you got to do it for posting.
No, I know, but you can always cancel it.
Yeah, we can post, but we can
withdraw
it at any time.
That's why I'm saying decide it now. She can post it now. And if on Thursday we decide not to, we can cancel it.
So we do 9:30 and 9 o'clock again on Saturday?
9, and I don't anticipate it going till 2.
No.
No, I don't either, but I think if we spend... We needed 3 hours. We could spend 3 hours.
Well, let's plan on 3 hours.
After the 3rd,
just for
or 4, just to.
All right, 1 o'clock.
This was going to be the editing period here, and then.
So Mike and Tanya, is 9 okay, or would 10 be better for you?
I mean, 10 would be great, but I'm not going to hold up the.
No, because we can do 10.
So
yeah, we can.
Yeah,
if we're only doing,
we can. So
we can do 10.
Yeah. Intent was to have the Thursday and the 3rd, and then.
That if Saturday, the 5th.
But what are we still thinking? You're still thinking about the every other week or every week in December on Thursdays? The 10th and 17th.
We've only got 2 weeks. That's the
right.
Yeah. So the review, some of it falls on us and some of it falls on Collins.
Yeah.
Right.
So we would have rests there.
Yeah. I originally scheduled it. Yeah, review by the commission first. Then we would take it back, and then the final review would be by. The commission, but you know, obviously it might be going on simultaneously since we're going to be in a crunch time.
So on your end, what do you need to do? Just now go through? Is someone on your end going through each section that we've gone through just to make sure that it's kosher?
Once we get the transition piece done, we'll be sending it up to two people, to our boss, Steve, the director, and then Marilyn Contreras, who's...
she's the guru.
She's the guru. She's the,
they defer to her.
The oracle.
The AG's office.
So none of this has gone anywhere yet, right?
No.
You're still draft form working.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, and honestly, it needs a lot of formatting work and stuff like that, you know, which will fall on
us. And then...
I think our folks, you know, Steve and Marilyn, if we, you know, we give them a week, they'll do it in a week.
We should warn them.
So, you know, if you can, I mean...
That opens up some time.
Yeah, it opens up some
that
time.
That does.
The other piece that maybe you guys can be working on through, you know, simultaneously, if we're to time on, is the preliminary report to accompany the...
Well, yeah, because for us to get it printed, and I also need a definitive answer on what qualifies to getting the preliminary in the hands of the registered voters, whether a circular qualifies or if we mail. Not that it's a huge issue, but it does make a difference.
Budgeting, it comes down to appropriations.
Does, because we have to move for that. And also, once we get a pretty clear picture of how many pages this thing is to print, because we're going to have to find a printer too.
Yeah. So yeah, I forget if I emailed Marilyn that question or not, but in any case, I will email either again or for the first time, Marilyn, that question.
Do we have to do an RFP for the printing?
Yeah, I don't think the dollar amount will be high enough to require an RFP. I think we're probably going to be able to do it with three quotes. But if you're asking, do we have to follow the procurement regulations?
Yeah, we do. I know we have to follow procurement.
Should we be able to do this the same way we do with the town warrant? I mean, the warrant is as important as this.
That's what she's asking, because we don't know if it can go in a circular.
I mean, we don't mail the warrant to everybody, and that's as significant.
But there may be a difference in
how it's delivered. Yeah, I just want to make sure.
We got to get this to as many people as possible and make sure that they get it.
I'm not reading for 12 days.
And
yes,
and we need to know soon enough, because if we have to take action, we'll need to look. I know where we sit with our budget right now. And then I'll slide the secondary payment into Collins Center and back out and see where we are. Because right now I have no idea once we get that printing, and then it makes a difference if we have the mail. That's going to cost us a lot.
Well, now, do we have to go back to the Board of Selectmen if we need another appropriation?
We would not go through them. We could do reserve fund transfer if we have to.
It has to be signed by them.
Yes.
Okay.
But they also, in the final one, which I have to go before them, is let them know that they are responsible for the final one.
I knew that.
I don't think they know that.
No, but whenever we can do that, we all should go.
Yeah, and, you know, handing out the copy of the state law
let's
look
into
care
that.
Of that.
Well, hopefully.
So, you would help.
Don't plan on them reading it.
No.
Tell them what it says.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Tom's ready to stay.
Okay. All right, so does everyone
looks lost to the date.
Right now,
we're crunching. Can we hand it to when?
So nothing we just discussed that messes you up?
No,
not yet.
Who we need to give heads up to when?
Not yet.
Mike is going to owe his wife big time.
Don, what needs to be in the preliminary report as opposed to the charter itself?
The charter.
Itself.
The draft. And then
we have to have a public hearing.
And which we'll have to discuss time for that. There are also, I believe in the final report, is sort of a position paper, and if there were a minority position within this group, which as far as I can see right now, there is not one, but I'm not precluding that happening.
Yeah, okay.
So I would also ask that we all, first let's move to adjourn.
Well, do we need to accept the minutes first?
Yeah, we got minutes.
Oh, okay.
We'll to accept the minutes.
I'll second it.
Discussion?
I
want to thank Marge from going from tape and doing a good job of discerning what went on.
The only thing that I will say, and I did contact Marge about this, I was here on the...
We received the revised one.
Yes. And there was a revised one sent out. But this one doesn't reflect the revision.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so that's my only comment. But otherwise, I'm good.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Now?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.